As we reviewed the fundamentals of both the natural and human-enhanced greenhouse effect, the importance of the element carbon to this process becomes very clear. For students, it may be helpful to utilize a role-playing simulation to help them more fully understand how and why carbon moves around the planet. In this simulation, students will role-play becoming an atom of carbon on a journey throughout the carbon cycle. Since carbon atoms move by chance, we will use dice to determine the random way they move throughout the cycle, following the pathways that carbon can take moving from one location to another. The simulation we'll be using comes from a version developed by the Peggy Notebaert Nature Museum. Now let's review the components of the simulation so we all understand the pieces and parts that are involved in having students take this carbon cycle journey. In the room, you'll have set up stations where the students can find the locations where carbon can be found on the planet. These will be designated by cards created with the title of the location, along with hopefully some kind of pictorial or photographic graphic to help them see more dramatically where the carbon can be found. At each of these stations, there will also be individual die that are utilized for each station to show the students as they toss these die where they go next in their carbon cycle journey. So each die is unique to the particular location or station where the carbon can be found because each pathway is unique. Students will also need data sheets to help them record their journey as they take this carbon cycle pathway around the planet, and they will just simply record the locations where carbon can be found as they go from station to station. It's important to understand how carbon can be found at these different locations and what those pathways are for it to move to other locations on the planet. So let's just spend a couple minutes just reviewing how carbon is found in these different locations and how it's able to move in various ways to other parts of the planet. First of all, carbon, of course, can be found in the atmosphere. Carbon is paired with two atoms of oxygen in the form of carbon dioxide. It can remain in the atmosphere, become part of plants through photosynthesis, or dissolve in ocean waters. Carbon can be found in plants and animals. Carbon is part of a chain in a tree trunk, sugar in a fruit, or in the muscle of an animal. It can be respired by plant or animals into the atmosphere or become part of the soil as the organism decays. Carbon can be found in the soil. Carbon enters soil as part of a chain in plant material such as a fallen leaf. It can remain in the soil, be carried downstream to the ocean, develop into a fossil fuel, or be released into the atmosphere as part of the decaying process. Carbon can also be found in the surface ocean. Carbon is dissolved in the surface of the ocean. It can remain in the ocean, be released into the atmosphere, be carried deeper into the ocean by currents, or become part of marine life through photosynthesis. Carbon is also found in the deep ocean. Carbon is dissolved in the deeper waters of the ocean. It can remain in the deep ocean, settle to the bottom of the ocean as sediment, or move to the ocean's surface by currents. Marine life also contains carbon. Carbon is part of a chain, an algae, or a marine animal. It can be exhaled by marine life and return to the surface of the ocean or become part of the deep ocean when the marine life dies. Ocean sediments can also hold a large amount of carbon. Carbon is part of the material that settles to the bottom of the ocean and will become sedimentary rock. It can either become a fossil fuel after 10 million years or be released into the atmosphere when a volcano erupts, releasing carbon dioxide. And finally, carbon can be found in fossil fuels. Carbon is part of a chain in oil, coal, or natural gas. It can remain as a fossil fuel or be released into the atmosphere after it's been burned for human use. Now that we understand all the components of the simulation, we'll get ready to actually role play this game. Now let's step through how students actually complete the simulation. In the room, you'll have set up the stations where the carbon can be found, along with the associated die, which help the students know how to journey from location to location. The students will take their data sheets and pick a location of their choice to begin. They will write the name of that first location on the top line on their data sheet under the the first column. Then, on a cue from the teacher, students will begin to toss those die gently to see where they should go next on their journey. The die are specific to each location, so make sure those stay at those initial stations. When students see where they should journey to, they will physically move to that next location and write that second location on their data sheet. You will note, and should explain to the students ahead of time, that on many of the die, there is a command to stay at that station. As you know, carbon has the ability to be trapped or captured in a particular place in the carbon cycle for oftentimes long periods of time. And so this is a very real aspect of the actual nature-driven carbon cycle. If students get the stay command on their die, they simply write that same location on the data sheet again, a second, third, fourth, however many times they need to. That is just the same as having made a journey to a new location. After the students have completed 10 of the rounds of this first part of the simulation, they will sit down and we will prepare for the second round. I will now demonstrate how this actual process will work. So I have chosen to start at the plant and animal station. And so I've written, as students would do, that location down on the first line of my data sheet. I simply toss the die, toss the die, and it tells me that my next stop should be atmosphere. So before I even move, I'm going to go ahead and write atmosphere down, so I don't get a little ahead of myself and forget to record that. So atmosphere is my next stop, and as we go to atmosphere, I will toss the die also, of course, and it actually gives me the stay command, stay at atmosphere. So I will write atmosphere down again, because I'm trapped there in the atmosphere for various reasons. And so, toss the die again for my fourth round, and it tells me to journey back to plant and animal. So I will write plant and animal down. And as students are doing this, it's important for them to kind of review in their minds that process we talked about how carbon is physically moving on those pathways. So you might ask them to kind of think about that as they're becoming that carbon atom moving through the cycle. Let's stop there now that you have an idea of how the process works. We're now ready to begin round two, but first we might need to make a slight change in the game components. An historic event has occurred which has changed the naturally driven carbon cycle. We'll discuss that more after we collect our data. But for now, we need to remove and swap out four of the die for dice which reflect a change in the process of the carbon cycle as it connects to this historic event. So we're going to actually swap out our atmosphere die for a different one. We're going to swap out our soil die for a new one. Our ocean sediment die and our fossil fuel die. After this has been completed, we are ready to start round two. So the second round should go fairly smoothly because students now know what to do. They'll start at the same location they started in round one. So I began at plant and animal. So I put that down in my data sheet in the second column as my first stop in the carbon cycle. Same process, we'll toss the die and see where I go this time. I go to atmosphere. So I write atmosphere down in the second line of my data sheet and physically journey to that next location. Atmosphere, I will toss. And I get stay at atmosphere. So we'll put that down as a repeat. Toss again. And I get stay at atmosphere. Let's do it one more time and see if I can leave the atmosphere. Unfortunately, for my fifth stop, I am still at atmosphere. We'll stop there. Okay, we've completed the simulation with our class, and now it's time to look at the information that was gathered and to discuss its meaning. So the students will take their individual data sheets where they've recorded their journeys in the two rounds of that game, and they'll notice that there's a table at the bottom of the data sheet. They'll take time to individually document how many times they stopped at each location in the carbon cycle journey for each of those two rounds. Some discussion can then take place about how they had different results as individuals as they made that journey. And there's some rich discussions that can be had as you look at that. But then we want to look as a class more closely at the larger data set and try to understand sort of the big picture idea. What's really important as we see the carbon cycle use or carbon move through the earth and we see humans' effects on that cycle. So we can take the information that the students gathered and create a class set of data and then look specifically at two areas where we can see some changes occurring in the carbon abundance over time. So we're going to look at atmosphere and fossil fuels. So we'll capture the number of times students landed in atmosphere location in the first round, which we're going to call the pre-1700 round, and in our second round, which we'll call post-1700. And we'll do the same for fossil fuels. Now you might be thinking, well, we have the two rounds and we're kind of representing them in these time periods. What is the key to understanding why that particular time period caused this very dramatic change? And if you think carefully about it, it's of course the Industrial Revolution. So about that time period in our history, humans began to find a rich source of energy possibilities in utilizing fossil fuels and began to remove fossil fuels and burn them for energy, thus creating some very dramatic differences in the abundance of carbon in the atmosphere and also the abundance of carbon in its traditional deep storage areas in the earth. So once we've gathered those numbers from the students as a whole, we can represent this information graphically by creating some simple bar charts as we have here. And so we can look at atmosphere over time, pre and post 1700, and the fossil fuel abundance pre and post 1700. And this is a great visual for the students to see the change based on that historic moment in the human's history and our anthropogenic effects on the carbon cycle. So we hope, by stepping you through the simulation, you can see that this very dramatically illustrates how fossil fuels, once serving as a sink of carbon storage, have increasingly been released, starting with the Industrial Revolution in the 1700s, and they have now become a source of carbon, building up primarily in our oceans and our atmosphere.